Okay, let's go ahead. I don't have slides. I'm aiming to walk through code as much as possible, but I made very brief notes about the areas to go through, starting from the working of AI run and AI add through the execution of macro, looking at the immediate mode execution, the relationship between the macro descriptions and the macro C# objects, the new compilation of NAPA Basic and the resulting objects, and then command mode execution, and differences to the immediate mode and some performance consideration, and then some possibilities for further future improvements. So let's look at the service functions first that are starting macro execution. So we have run db7 and add, and they go to AI service function execute macro, which is one of the starting points here. They process the parameters of the macro, and then depending on on whether we are calling it with add or run, we either execute it in immediate mode or run in task, which is the AI add task mode, also called immediate command mode, or the regular command mode. One topic that this reminds me is this is the task stack and task loops old and refactored. So as you some of you know, we in the VPF NAPA we use a new way to handle tasks and task stack, but I'm not sure, that might be a bit out of scope for this session, and there are others like Lauri and Julian and Antti perhaps, who know quite much about that anyway. So we will not go to that. But the main difference between these modes here is that the run internal, the command mode, is simply pushing the macro to the macro stack, but not executing it, and it will then rely on the current task later pulling commands from the macro one by one. Whereas the immediate mode is more simple and more modern, it will push the macro to the stack and it will execute the macro, but it cannot execute any task-bound commands because they can only be executed by the task pulling them. Let's look at that chain. So let's look at the immediate mode execution pathway first. Here we have the macro run immediate mode. But actually, let's take one step backward first and look where the macro is coming from when we are loading it. That's also important. So before we start running the macro, at this point we already have the macro as a description, so it has been loaded from somewhere. And the main location, the main routine that is handling for getting a macro based on the macro name is get macro from default source. And that's very important routine, and that is located in the file called AI macro cache. That's, you know, related to the macro cache because that's one of the locations where we are getting. So when we are running the macro with AI add or run, and we give some name of the macro, this is the routine that tries to find the macro and load it for us. And there are several possibilities what can happen here. The first check is if the macro is a local subroutine of the current macro. If that is the case, then this get NAPA basic subroutine will return it immediately. The next important step here is to check the macro cache. So macro cache is used to increase NAPA performance. So when a macro is being executed, I will move this conversation to the other pane so I'm able to see it while we are going forward. So as the macro cache, instead of loading and compiling the macro every time when a macro is executed, which was the way far in the past, if a macro has been already executed before, it will be retained in the macro cache so that the next execution is much faster. And nowadays, before 2015, the macro cache was only retaining the macro description, the text. But nowadays, the macro cache is retaining automatically also the compiled C# object model of the macro. So also the compilation needs to be only once. And macro cache has been moved to C# side only rather recently, about 6 months ago. So this is one of the more recent C# migrations. And one of the advantage of moving the macro cache here is that we can use simple, effective, performant C# dictionary for mapping the macro names to the macro objects. Whereas in the Fortran side, it was just some records and descriptions which are not very effective. That needs to be searched in a linear way. And here, what we are actually storing in the macro cache are the macro C# objects, which we will look into more detail. But they are located here in this macro CS, NAPA core, NAPA basic macro CS. And I've right here, traditionally macros are represented as descriptions in the Fortran core, but starting from 2014, I have been creating this C# wrapper, and actually it's much more than wrapper nowadays. Most of the data, most of the runtime data related to a macro is now living only as C# data in this C# class. And then there is a very important one-to-one relationship between these descriptions and these wrapper objects. So each macro Fortran macro description, there is one macro wrapper C# objects, and for each object there is one description. This relationship needs to be maintained at least as long as these descriptions, you know, remain macro representation. So the macro cache is nowadays rather simple. We can add a macro and we can get a macro. There is one complication, and this complication comes in some other parts of the AI as well, and that is for recursive macros. Unfortunately, I mean, NapaBasic does support recursive calls of macro calling itself, directly or indirectly, but it's not very easy because the macro description contains the macro local variables, whereas when you are calling something recursively, the new function call must have its own local variables. And this problem is solved in a hacky way by checking when we are getting a macro here, checking whether we have this macro already in the macro stack. And if so, instead of returning the macro from the cache, we are returning a clone of that macro, which is also cloning the macro description. And this is not very good. There's been historically bugs with this mechanism, and that's why one of my, you know, long-term, you know, development proposal is to remove the macro local variables from the macro description and move them to the C# macro stack, and that would clean up this problem as well. So this was getting the more accurately, the size of the macro stack is limited to 100. So even if you would have 100 different macros, you can only have 100 levels. It's an arbitrary number. We are just throwing exception. If one tries to have more, that number can be changed. But it's a quite good assumption that no real valid NapaBasic, you know, like a program needs more than that. You shouldn't use recursion as a fine-grained, you know, tool to do some stuff. Even if you would have unlimited levels, this requirement for cloning would make it very, very bad and slow idea. Perhaps not so, but in some cases it's very useful. So. It's still there. Yeah. So again, coming back to this, get macro from default source. First was the subroutine, then was the macro cache, and then if it's not from the cache, then it is searched from databases 1 to 7 with DB. Description read, and if it's not found from any of the databases, then here we have this new mechanism for loading macro from a text file, which is implemented here. So there's a separate file macro search path. This was the new feature for 19.1 macro search path, which is using the global variable and environment variable NAPA macro search path, and then trying to find whether the macro is found from any of the search path, and if found, then loading from there. Again, not very large file, 90 lines here, so rather quick implementation. And if it's not found even from the search path, then that's an error, and we will return zero from this routine in that case. Finally, we are setting the date and name to the macro object. And in the end, if we did find a macro, we call create macro object function, which is a call to the C# side. You can, by the way, you can spot the C# calls that they, because they are using the camel case or the capital case in the function names, whereas the Fortran calls are using the uppercase. So this is a call to the C# side, create macro object, and all these calls are found from the NAPA manage access NAPA basic namespace. You can see that they have all native accessible flags. So this is like the API or the interface of the C# AI. These functions are then called from the Fortran side to access those. And here we had the what we were searching for, the create macro object. So immediately after we have been loading the new macro, it is checking first whether we already have a wrapper object for this macro, and if not, then it is creating a new wrapper object with this create macro info function. And now I can show here how this one-to-one mapping between the macro objects and the descriptions are handled. So we have this global static variable, static dictionary, macro info cache that's handled by the macro CS, and basically it's a dictionary mapping macro description number to the macro wrapper object. And this is needed because in large areas of the Fortran code we are passing around macros as the reference numbers only. And then if this reference number, if we want to do something to this reference number to the C# side, we need to get the macro object, wrapper object for that reference number, and this dictionary handles that. And of course this kind of static dictionaries leave possibility for the bug that some macro objects would be left there in the dictionary even after the description has been deleted, and in order to prevent that, we are actually in this file we are also listening to the DM to the deletions of descriptions. So when we are setting up this, we are setting up a subscription to listen to events of whenever DM is deleting a description. So in this way, if to avoid memory leaks, if some Fortran code is deleting a macro in some unexpected or non-standard way, we are still able to remove the corresponding macro object through this method. So if we have a wrapper for that, then we are deleting that macro and removing it from the map. Here, by the way, there's also the concept of reference count. So this macros use this kind of primitive reference counting for memory management. Whenever we detect that some new permanent reference to a macro is made, we can increase the reference count, and then when the macro when the reference is given away, we decrease the reference count, and this decreasing reference count ensures that when the reference count goes to zero, then we are deleting the description and removing the macro from this map of the descriptions to the objects. So this raises another future possibility, and the future possibility would be that in the future it might be possible to extend this AI implementation so that this that macros wouldn't need to be handled as descriptions anymore. Most of the runtime data and runtime execution is handled by the C# data structures, and at runtime there's very little need anymore for the description itself. So it could be only in the future only a temporary artifact during the loading of the macro, and then we would have everything else in C#. Okay, then I go back here. So now we have been loading the macro successfully and creating the wrapper object, and this was finishes the getting of the macro from the standard source. And then we get to the running of the macro in immediate mode, and here we are pushing the macro to the macro stack. We are increasing its reference count, executing its lines, getting result value, popping it from the stack, and decreasing the macro reference count. So you can see this immediate execution is clean in a way that we do all these steps one by one immediately. So when this routine ends, the macro has been completely executed. This is in contrast to the command mode, where we are pushing the macro to the macro stack, but then the execution happens later, and when the macro ends is not determined, you know, anymore. But the main things here is pushing the macro to the macro stack and then executing its lines in immediate mode. And this macro stack, as you can see from the call, that's also in C# side nowadays, since about one year ago. And that is, you know, preparing for moving the macro variables to the macro stack. Now it's in the C#, so it's possible to move more stuff there. So let's look at that. We have another interop wrapper called macro stack access that has native accessible methods for pushing and popping macros from stack, checking whether there's macro in the stack, checking the height of the macro stack, and so on. The macro stack itself, it's a singleton object in the macro stack instance variable, and its methods are implemented in macro stack CS in the NAPA Basic namespace, and this is about 200 lines long. Again, not too big, reasonably compact. And there's two main classes here. There's the macro stack itself, where the main field is the static singleton instance, and then the stack data itself, which is a list of macro execution stack frames, and the macro execution stack frames contain reference to the macro, to the mode, which can be immediate or command mode, the level, the name of the macro, and then there is also a field for the variables. But note that this is not containing the variables, it is just referencing the local variables of the macro, which still at the moment live in the macro description. But this is preparing for the future possibility that these variable values would actually stay here in the stack frame as they should properly. So now the macro has been pushed to the stack, and now we call the execution of the lines here. And this is interop wrapper, which is delegating further here to routine called execute lines in immediate mode. This is in the in the file called command reading, which also handles the command mode getting of commands from the macro. But in this case of the execute immediate mode, we have basically a while loop, which is executing as long as we have this one macro in the stack, meaning as long as the result of the statement execution doesn't return end of macro. So we have this statement result code end of macro. Each statement execution returns some value, and some of the values are special codes, and one special code is this end of macro. So we are basically repeating the execution. We are repeatedly executing statements as long as we don't get this this end of macro thing. And as you know, we are it is forbidden to have task-bound commands in immediate mode macros. We can have transparent commands in immediate macros, and we can see that soon. But basically, when we are calling this get next task command, we should not get a task command in an immediate mode macro. And because of that, if actually some command is returned from the macro, then we are printing an error AI macro containing NAPA commands in wrong context. So this is the error you will see if you are having commands in immediate mode macro. And that's understandable, because if we get a command string at this point in this routine, there's no place where we can return this command for the execution, because we are coming here from this routine. That's not a task. So we go down here. I skip some levels now, where we are now looking at the execution, and this is calling the inner method get next command, and this is calling inner method execute next line. And now we are going back to the macro CS. So execute next line is very central routine in the new AI. So this is being called both for command mode and immediate mode macros for executing statements in the macro. And if the statement is a command, if this line contains a command, then the result of this execute next line is that command. Jan is asking, in the macro stack frame there was global variables. How are these resolved? So global variables are contained in one global record in NAPA. Let's go back to the macro stack. Again, this is just a wrapper. So this is global variables is calling get global variables, which is calling calculator wrapper get global variable records. So NAPA has single global description that contains four records for global variables, and these are fetched from the Fortran side. And then this routine is simply returning the information in those records with some wrappers. There are some C# wrapper classes like variable rex and variable info that are wrapping that data. But basically it's mapping to the globals that are in the Fortran. This So the fact that we have in the macro stack here list of variables and global variables, this is not related to visibility at all. When we are talking of visibility, then we must go, the visibility is relevant when we are executing individual NAPA basic statements. For example, if we have a let's put here visibility of variables. For example, if we have statement x equals y, then NAPA AI must resolve this symbol y, and the symbol y might be resolved to global variable or local variable or common variable or quantity, for example. And that depends in complex way on different rules that the macro might define. And how this variable is being resolved to different things depending on the context, we can look at that. But that's not related to the fact that we are keeping here a reference as global variables. The main reason actually why we have the variables and global variables here is at the moment, the main reason is for the VS Code debugger. So the VS Code debugger, if you are stepping in a macro, it will show the current global and local variables when you are stepping in the macro. And it is getting them from these data structures. So this macro execution stack frame is also doubling, not only for the AI execution, but it's also doubling for sending data to the VS Code via the VS Code interop for the debugging purposes. If we see, for example, how this global variables is being referenced, it shows zero references. And the reason is that this is only referenced when we are serializing this macro stack frame as JSON to be sent to the VS Code. That's the only way it's used at the moment. Okay, then. Yeah, then we were in the central place of executing next line. Oops. What I usually do if I want to debug some execution of NAPA Basic, I usually put the breakpoint. You can see here also I have already a breakpoint, a disabled breakpoint here somewhere in this routine. It's a very good place to put the breakpoint. When you step. When you break on that breakpoint, it will break there exactly once for each line in NAPA Basic macro execution. Whether it's a command, whether it's a statement, whatever is on that line, it will break here. And it's very easy to inspect stuff here when we break here, because we have all these local variables, we have all these class level variables. We can inspect the content. We don't need any description viewer nowadays to look at the macro content. We can inspect the string lines of the macro. Everything is easier to debug, you know. And this is a good place for the breakpoint. And then from here we can go downward to execute individual statement type execution. Here the next level downward is execute compiled statement out there, and here we have various cases, but the main routine to call downward is to execute compiled statement, and here we have various cases again for some statement types, and then one type here is calling some statement objects execute method. but for some cases we're special. So it's possible to debug downward here, you know, for a different statement type execution. And we might consider debugging AI execution. That's something that might be interesting to try out as well. I will let's see which directory I have attached here. I have work temp, so I would, just in case we want to try that at some point, I will start here. NAPA that we can use for that purpose. There's one problem, of course, in putting a breakpoint here, is that when we are having a NAPA running, there are regularly macros being executed. For example, on the NAPA main window, we have timer callbacks. We have at least one timer callback that's checking the license, and we have another timer callback that's checking the debugging request from the VS Code. And those are triggering, I think, once or twice per second. So when you do put a breakpoint here, let's do that now. And now let's enable this breakpoint. Oh, source code is different from the original version. Did I change something? I don't know. But just in case, I can also compile it. Ah, yeah, I had some new code. Actually, I was fixing a bug that was related to subroutines being inside other subroutines and cleaning up code there. So that's actually okay to compile. Okay, but before we get to the execution, let's look still more to the pushing of the macro to the stack. So here we have the macro stack, and then this push was being called for the macro before we started executing lines in the macro. And this calls the macro push to stack. And macro push to stack is actually quite important nowadays, because for better performance, AI also uses lazy compilation nowadays. So even if you load some macro from the disk and you create some object wrapper for that, that will still not compile the macro. So the macro is compiled only the first time it is being pushed for execution to the stack. And that was triggered by this. After pushing to the stack, the macro push to stack is being called. And here we will check whether the macro is already compiled, and if not, the macro will be compiled. And this is quite interesting area. So this is for very long time in the NAPA history, there was no compilation of macros at all. And that means that even if you had a for loop in the macro that was executed 10,000 times, each statement, when it was executed, it was interpreted again and again from the string line in the record of the description. So each time a line in a macro was executed, it was interpreted from the string again. And of course, this is quite obviously, not clever for performance. And the historically, I think the main reason is that because in Fortran, the data structures are so bad and clumsy that it was not, there was no easy way to describe with some reasonable performant data structure. It was not easy to describe the statement. So it was just convenient to keep the statement as a string. And then at the same time, when the statement was being interpreted, it was being executed. So then there was no need to retain some kind of data structure that is storing the representation of a statement. You were just reading, interpreting, executing, and throwing away. So the major difference here is that we are compiling the macro each line to various object representations. It doesn't go all the way. There are two main limitations to this compilation that I might also write here. So commands are not compiled, or they are compiled to the NAPA command statement type, but the NAPA command statement type is just storing the command as a string. So that's just a wrapper. And then calculator expressions are compiled, but in Fortran to Fortran data structures. So there was, although I said there was no compilation of NAPA Basic, the old AI and the old calculator did have mechanisms for compiling calculator expressions and then storing them with this kind of arrays and then executing them from those arrays. And I guess the reason for that might be that there are some old usages of NAPA calculator expressions. You can use NAPA calculator expressions in other ways than as macro. For example, you can calculate some function using NAPA calculator expressions. So perhaps already earlier it was discovered that the performance for using those calculator expressions was so bad that probably Jan von Hartmann was then making a way to compile calculator expressions to some Fortran arrays and then executing them from those Fortran arrays. And this AI, C-sharp AI, is using that mechanism still. So it is compiling all the NAPA basic statements to C-sharp objects, but then all the calculator expressions in those statements are compiled at the moment still in the Fortran data structures, and then executed from them. And an obvious future proposal would be to also compile the calculator statements to C-sharp and execute from C-sharp, which is at the moment the performance bottleneck, after all these other changes. And that would have other benefits also. So let's look at the steps in the compilation. We are creating a NAPA basic compiler object. That's a separate class, a compiler class. We will look into this, which is about 500 lines, and then it is decrypting the macro if it's a encrypted or protected macro, because otherwise we cannot read the statements. And then it is processing the subroutines of the macro. And this is again something that is still done in the Fortran, and not only done in the Fortran, but done in the Fortran in a bit nasty way. And it's an obvious idea to move also this subroutine processing implementation to C# and perhaps improve the implementation, how it's done. In all other respects, when the macro is compiled, we don't actually touch the lines of the macro. So the compilation is producing new C# data structures that represent the lines of the macro, but they are not mangling, they are not modifying, they are not mutating the macro itself. In the past, if you remember, for example, when you were in the 2009 NAPA, when you were stepping a macro in the step mode, the macro that you were stepping in the step mode, when you look at the statements, they were actually different statements from the statements that you saw in the macro when you were editing it. For example, if then else statements, they were pre-processed by you know, the old AI, they were pre-processed to go to statements. So the macro at the runtime, how it looked like, didn't look like the macro that you were editing. Now that has been all going away now. Now in 99% of the case, when we are compiling the macro, we are not touching the existing macro. We are creating the C# objects, but the macro lines, the string lines, remain as they are. This is very nice for the Visual Studio Code stepping debugging, and for the step mode, when we are debugging the macro, we see the macro as it is. But there's one exception, and that's the subroutines. So when the subroutines are still processed in a pre-processing way, where for each subroutine a new macro object is being created, and the subroutine is deleted from the original macro. And when I say deleted, originally the deletion, the deleting meant that those lines where the subroutine was, they were removed from the macro description. The problem with that is that that is changing the numbering of the lines. So for the Visual Studio Code debugging, what we changed was that instead of removing those lines, we are replacing the lines of the subroutine now with empty lines. So then the line numbering in the macro doesn't change, but it's still nasty that we have this long block of space, you know, in the beginning of the macro in the version that we are debugging. So that's something that's you know, obvious, you know, suggestion for possible, you know, future improvement. And that would allow other improvements. Like at the moment, subroutines cannot call other subroutines. So you cannot have five subroutines in a macro that will be calling each other. That's a very annoying limitation for using subroutines. Okay, so subroutines are being processed, and then we create wrappers for those. We add the end of macro flag record that is responsible for returning the end of macro code in the end. And then the main compilation method is calling compile macro from the compiler. And this is returning a tuple of values. It's returning the list of compiled lines, and then it is returning separately the parameters statement and the declarations of the macro. They are handled separately, like the global, local, and such declarations. Let's look at the compilation more detailed. So the main compilation loop is here, this while loop that is going through all the lines of the macro. And when I say lines, we are now still operating with the macro with the records and as records and descriptions. So we are looping through the records of the macro description. And we are doing some replacements from of tabs. For example, tabs should work as spaces in NAPA Basic, so we are replacing tabs with spaces. And recently we also found that when people were copy pasting macros from some Skype, they were getting these nasty non-breaking space characters there that were looking like spaces but were behaving differently, so we replaced them away as well. And finally we convert away this kind of symbolic character codes like these kind of codes that we support that are mainly used in docu macros for some special symbols. And then the main compilation for the line is that we take the line and we call compile method, which returns the compiled statement. Let's look at that. And compile is like the classic main routine for the parsing of the statement. So it is basically inspecting the line one by one with different statement types and checking whether it matches that statement type. For example, if we have a go to statement, it is trying to parse the statement with the go to, and if it matches, then we will return a new go to statement with various attributes. So you can see these different statements. If the parser matches those statements, then we are constructing and returning a new statement object that corresponds to that statement. Let's take some example. Let's take example of this for each, which is the new statement that was coming a few years ago, and which was, you know, remarkably simple to add, you know, to this new statement structure, and which is also trying to serve as an example how, you know, it can be actually quite efficient to add new kind of features here. So when we are detecting a for each statement, we are constructing a new for each statement object with the content of the statement and the macro, the parent macro. And the for each statement has a syntax where it has for each name of a variable, the keyword in, and then some expression. And here we are using a regular expression. Again, it's easy to use the regular expressions in this parser in the C# side, which makes you know, making of the parser much nicer. So we are matching. So we are using regular expressions regularly, you know, for analyzing different statement structures, and then we are capturing the name of the variable, and if we don't have a match, we will throw a syntax error. One thing to notice here, that is because we are in the C# side, we can throw exceptions. So when again, throwing exception is very convenient when we are deep somewhere, you know, for example, compiling something, we can just throw exceptions, and then the exception will propagate up as long as needed, and we will then catch it on the high level without, you know, pushing forward. So once this expression and the variable have been parsed, then we will store the name of the variable from the regular expression, and we will store the expression for the array value by compiling it to calculator expression object. The calculator expression is another object wrapper that is wrapping any calculated expressions in the statements. And like I said, they are compiled also, but they are not compiled here on the C# side. They are compiled at the moment with the old Fortran compilation mechanism, and it would be an attractive idea to re-implement that in the C#. I will quickly go step into this calculator expression wrapping. So class calculator expression, it is storing the expression as a string, but the main evaluation of this is checking first whether the expression is compiled. If not, it will compile the expression by using the Fortran routine parse expression, again written before my time. And this parse expression will return two arrays. They are the again, because Fortran doesn't have good structured types for this kind of expressions, as a poor man's data structure, Jan von Hartmann was using arrays that are then encoding the content of the expression in various ways. But in this routine, we don't have to care how these arrays are encoding the expression. We are simply storing them here. Other one is a double array, and other one is an integer array. We store them as the compiled representation, and then each time we evaluate this expression, we are calling the Fortran routine calc evaluate compiled expression, and we pass on the compiled arrays, and that is evaluating the expression. And then in the for each statement, we are storing this array expression, and then you can see that this for each statement is rather compact in its implementation, not rocket science with all these services. Basically, when we are calling next, we are getting the items, and we are moving to the next item. Items is an enumerator over the record items, and if the enumerator has an item, then we will assign local variable from the macro object with the variable name and the current value, and then we will loop. We will go to the beginning of the loop. If we don't have any more items, we go to the end of the loop. So this serves as an example how with these new C# services, it's reasonably small code and reasonably readable code to make these kind of new services. So that was example of the compilation of for each to the for each statement. And then one, if we don't have any of these special statements that start with some keyword like go to return for each while next end and so on, then the final and perhaps the most there's two final cases. One is assignment. So assignment is looking for name. It's looking for delimiter, the equal mark as a delimiter, and if it's finding equal mark as a delimiter, then it is parsing the statement as an assignment statement. And then if none of these cases match, then the final conclusion is that this statement must be a NAPA command, and we will then parse it as a NAPA command. And now NAPA commands, of course, can have a rather complex structure, command parsing. For example, we can have this kind of command. So this kind of command has some static text, and then it has some embedded calculator expressions. For example, here x is calculator expressions, and here y plus 555 is another calculator expression. And then this, for example, if x is y and 1 is 2, then at the runtime, this would be resolved to this kind of string, and then this string would be returned to the current task for execution. So although we don't really compile NAPA commands, we do here analyze the structure of these kind of command statements, and we do extract and compile the calculator expressions that are on these statements, so that then the production of this final command string is quite effective, although the command string itself is then interpreted by the task separately. So let's look at this compilation. So this is done in the eval and replace calculator expressions over here in the compiler, and this has many special cases, but the main thing to see here is that this is a recursive function. So basically, it is starting the parsing from the beginning, and it is recursively breaking this string to the parts that for example, here we would produce an array which has the constant string ABC, then it would have the calculation expression X, then it would have the constant string JJIII, and then it would have the calculation expression Y plus JJJ, something like this. So we are recursively parsing this from the beginning to an array of parts, which might be constant parts or which might be expression parts. Calculator expression parts. So the result is a NAPA basic statement, and the various parts might be NAPA command statement, which refers to this kind of static string command, or if we have been finding an at character, meaning there's some calculator expression embedded, then we come here and then we take the initial command part, and then we recursively compile the rest of the statement. So we call back the recursion from the beginning. So that means that this kind of line can return this statement type called compound statement, which then has multiple parts like that. Okay, that concludes perhaps looking at the compilation of the macro, and then that was finished over here, and and then there's some things to note about some potential complications here. One is that although we, you know, for the performance reason, when we call a macro several times, again and again and again, we are using the same macro description from the macro cache with the same compiled C# objects. And that gives good performance, but there's some caveats. And one caveat is that because we are keeping the local variables still in the macro description itself, we need to make sure that each time the macro is pushed to the stack, we need to clear away the possible local variable state from the previous execution. Otherwise, we might get hanging local variables, you know, hanging from the previous execution. And for example, we recently had a bug with some combination of macro execution and subroutines where the subroutine parameter values were not being refreshed in a correct way because of this. And again, the correct way to fix this would be to move the macro local variables to the macro stack, as we were discussing. And then again, after we have been pushing, we will reset the next line to execute to null and the current line to null, meaning that when we are starting to execute the macro, we will then start from the beginning. And then another thing that we do here is that if we are executing this macro as part of the manager framework, the manager framework wants to have the vardef variables of the item visible in the init and creator macros. And it's possible to put the vardef variables. So it's possible to use statement called var from table. Was it AD var from table? Yep. Okay. That will take variables from some vardef table and put them to macro local variables. But the manager machinery, as you know, does this in an invisible way. So if a manager item is defining some vardefs, then when you execute the creator macro, the manager machinery takes care that those variables are automatically put there, visible to the macro, even if you have not been writing these kind of var from table statements. And the previous implementation for this was rather hacky, I would say. The previous implementation was that actually the manager machinery was behind the scene adding AD var from table statements to the macro itself. It was mangling the macro at runtime. And this was very nasty for debugging, because then even if you were executing the same macro, because it was being mangled in different ways in different locations, you actually in the end ended up with different versions of the macro at runtime. And that was very nasty. So along with the other removals of this kind of macro mangling, we were able to remove this case of the macro mangling so that now the manager machinery is not modifying the macro anymore. The macro is just like it is. But instead, the manager machinery is adding special metadata information to the macro, saying that, hey, by the way, I want this and this and this vardef table to be visible when you run the macro. And that is now handled here in the macro push to stack. So here we are calling the var from table implementation And basically what it does, it will loop over all the names of the var defs that have been defined in this metadata record, and it will execute the var from table statement here, getting those variables. And this is done now in the beginning when the macro is pushed to the stack before executing any other statement. So they will be visible from the beginning. And also before that, we are executing all these declaration statements. Declaration statements being like a parameter statement, local, global quantity, and so on, which are basically declaring types of variables. And again, in the past, these statements were executed at the point when we were getting to those statements in the macro, but now they are executed when the macro is being pushed to the macro stack, which is more sensible because they are really declarations about the macro and not really executable statements as such. And finally, we put the next line to execute as the first line of the macro, and then it's ready to go. So that happened on the macro pushing the stack. And then we can go back here to get next line to execute, which is then executing the lines. I will not go through the different statement types, but here they are here in the NAPA core, source, core, NAPA basic. So by the way, this NAPA basic core NAPA basic folder, this is the central and only location of all the C# AI. So this is the place to browse. And here the NAPA basic statement folder has special, unique statement classes for the different objects of the compiled NAPA basic. We were looking previously for the for each statement as an example, but there are others that can be looked from here. That concludes the immediate mode execution. The command mode execution is otherwise similar, but it can return commands to the task. So the immediate mode execution after pushing the macro to the stack to execute it in the immediate mode, we were calling this execute NAPA basic lines. That was calling execute lines immediate mode. Now, if we are executing it in command mode, the Fortran implementation will only push the macro to the stack, and then it will rely on the task in fetching those commands. I will not go here as far as looking at the Fortran side of this command execution chain, but this get task command from macro is the main interop level function that the tasks are calling to get commands from the macro. It's worth noting that when a task is calling this get task command from macro, it might result in execution of several NAPA basic statements. So as long as the next line has only NAPA basic and not the command, then we will loop and execute more lines until we get a task bound command, and only then we return it here and return it to the task. Okay, so get task command from macro is calling get next task command. It's almost the same, but here it's flagging that we are not in immediate mode, so immediate mode is false. And now we can look more detail here. So immediate mode was false now. And here we have a loop. We are looping here until we get a task bound command. And the main routine here was get next command. And if the command is returned, it's different from now. We are returning it if it's something else than a string, which is some special code like end of macro. But then an important case here is checking whether the command is a transparent command. So starting from about 1 year ago, around the same time as the AI macro stack, I moved the execution of transparent commands, which are the commands starting with an exclamation mark at this level. That's possible, you know, in principle, because the transparent commands are not bound to any task, so they can be executed in any task, and they can be also executed in immediate mode nowadays. So this checking and execution of the transparent command, it's not in any way related to whether we are in immediate mode or not. So feel free to try your favorite exclamation type command in immediate mode macro, and it works nowadays. So we are checking whether it matches the transparent command pattern, and if it does, then we will call the service function mn command to execute it. As you know, in the immediate mode, even in the past, you could have transparent commands executed with the mn command. But in some case, the syntax is more clean if you write them as real commands. And this will call get next command. And this get next command, the main logic that we have here and the main function that was moved here from the Fortran side was handling of multiple commands on the same line. Multi commands online. So it's possible in NAPA Basic to have ABC semicolon XYZ semicolon III. So it's possible to have multiple commands on the same line. And now when the task is requesting a command, what we do is that we are returning this first part of the command, but then we need to retain the remaining content of the line to be returned on the next call. So because of that, we have here a static string remaining command. So this is documented that when we have multiple commands on one line, we need to return them at the task one at a time. So if this happens, we will store here the remaining command, and then when we are reading the command, we will first check if we have or don't have any remaining command. If we have a remaining command, then we don't read anything from the macro. We will just read the next command from that remaining command buffer. And then, whereas if we don't have a remaining command, then we will loop in a while loop and read commands, read lines and execute lines from the current macro until we get a command until there is some command that is returned from the line. Again, remember, if the macro contains 1,000 lines of NAPA basic and then one command, then this loop will loop and execute all those 1,000 lines without returning, and only then we will get the command and we will process the command and return the command. And finally, when we have been getting a line with the command, we will take the first part of the command if it has semicolon separated parts, and then return that and store the rest in the buffer. Okay, that was the multipart commands. We are talking of the debugging. The task stack and the task loops, we will not really talk. One note about performance: this is a graph that I have been showing earlier in some other context. So one significant result from moving this execution to C sharp and using this compilation is to allow higher performance for the macro execution. Here's just a simple NAPA basic speed test that has a big loop that I have been using to track the performance of these changes starting from 2017, and this I have been using this to historically track also starting from the so-called golden 2009 version by Jarmon Hartman. Because of the significant differences in the AI add and in the command mode and immediate mode, I have been tracking and analyzing the performance separately on these two modes. And one thing we can notice that initially from 2019 to 2013, you know, when I had been doing initial round of AI refactorings on the Fortran side, but not having anything in the C sharp, actually the performance, especially the command mode, was dropping, you know, partly because of using more allocatable strings. And then when we did the first, in 2015 was the first versions of the C sharp AI, and here we see that it was mainly helping initially the performance of the immediate mode, because in the immediate mode we were looping the macro completely inside C sharp, whereas in the command mode we were always returning after each line, we were always returning to the Fortran side even if there was no command. And only then there were some intermediate improvements, and only in 18.3 I was finally able to extend the command mode execution so that in 18.3 we got this this command reading was being moved. This logic was being moved from Fortran to C sharp, and after that, if you are executing macros that have only NAPA basic statements in command mode, they are virtually as fast as in immediate mode, and significantly faster than in the history. So now we don't have a penalty for the command mode performance anymore. Of course, if you do have commands, then those are always slower, but you are not punished just for using the command mode if you have NAPA basic statements. Okay, that concludes my topics. I was also mentioned the calculator expressions to C sharp and the removal of macro description at runtime. Any comments or questions at this time? One thing to notice, I was mentioning this calculator expressions to C sharp and macro variables as C sharp. Although I mentioned here as main thing the performance and the architecture, I think there's a significant, you know, a possibility. .NET types as values for variables. So I think this is really the bigger drawback that could be or advantage that we could get from this, because at the moment, if you think of the NAPA basic types that you can use for variables and storing stuff, you have reference numbers, strings, and real numbers. That's it. Reference numbers can be NAPA basic arrays or they can be descriptions, but you are really, really limited in terms of data types that you can use. Extending, you know, storing the variables as on the C# side would allow the universe of .NET data and interop, you know, to be used here, and that could be very, very useful for the data structures and the interop. So I will not go through the Jira issues, but there is the in the Jira we have I think we have this epic NAPA basic epic NAPA basic improvements. Yeah, this is the epic I've been collecting here since 2016, various like high level improvements. Some of them are done, like this transparent comments in embedded mode macros and for each loop, but there are many improvement ideas that could be done, both features and refactorings. Here was, for example, the variable processing, the C#. Okay, thank you for listening, and you can come ask me any questions also later. Bye bye.